the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, what a wonderful day to gather in the Lord's name. Hey, Leslie, good to have you back home. It's good to have everybody here this morning. It's a beautiful, cool morning that the Lord has given us. And Miss Sue is going to do an announcement for us. She's much prettier than I am, so we'll give her the... Let her dress things up around here a little bit.
Bless your heart. Well, good morning. I'm sure all of you have used the phrase, it's free. I can't believe anything is free. But I'm telling you this morning, I'm going to talk to you about something that is actually free here at the church. As you know, the ladies, the LWML, put together a rummage sale every year. And throughout the year, many generous people throughout the congregation and the community come to the church and they donate. And so during the summer, when we are not here, Dale puts all these, he goes through all these things that people donate, he boxes them and puts them up in the attic for storage. Well, in the fall, of course, more people are here, so we get more donations, and so we start going through these, getting ready for a possible rummage sale. Anyhow, it has come to our attention that we have gathered through these donations lots and lots, an abundance of wrapping paper, Christmas bags, Christmas boxes, and Christmas ribbons. And of course, this is the time of the year that they are to be used. We have found when you save them till after the holidays, they don't go very well. So, with that dilemma, somebody in our congregation made an offer to make a generous donation to the LWML for the rummage sale fund with the stipulation that all these boxes and bows and ribbons and Christmas wrapping be given away free. So, after the service today, as you exit the church, there will be two tables out in the parking lot. And we are asking, as you go out of the church, please go through these beautiful wrappings. Some of them are gorgeous. The ribbons and bows. Look at them. Take what you can use. If you have neighbors or friends that can use them, please take for them as well. These will be offered today, this afternoon, and probably next Sunday, if we have any left. So please help yourselves. Thank you.
Wow, such a deal. Well, I don't have any major announcements, although for some folks it might seem major. We're making another change with the communion today, and we certainly welcome any feedback that you have. The elders the church council there, we're always trying to meet the needs of folks, and the little containers that we've been using for communion, for some of us young folks like me, it's very easy to get into and whatnot. But some of us have a little problems, you know, getting right side up or getting the wafers out and this sort of thing. So we have a new thing we are trying here, and and Dale graciously put this all together. There's a cup here that will be distributed by one of the elders at the time of communion. In the cup is a small individual communion cup. And also in here is the wafer. That, for some of us, may cause a little problem. But if you notice in the pew in front of you, there is a holder where if when you get that during the communion time, because we take the wafer first, what we will do then, I suggest that you remove the cup, place it in that holder. You with me? That way you'll be free to pick up very easily the wafer. And then at the proper time, I will tell you to take and eat and take and drink. Okay, with that, let us stand as we sing our first hymn. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Prepare the way of the Lord. Shower, O heavens, from above, and let the skies rain down righteousness.
Let the earth open and salvation.
For you are merciful, and you love your whole creation.
And we, your creatures, glorify you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades. When the breath of the Lord blows on it, surely the people are grass.
The grass withers, the flower fades,
but the word of our God stands forever.
Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him.
The Lord comes in judgment. As he comes, I stand guilty before him.
Standing guilty before our God, without an excuse, we confess our sins to him. We confess before you, O Lord, that we are sinful. We have failed to treasure your word. And as a result, we have lived our lives for ourselves instead of living our lives for you. You intended your word to shine forth light, yet at times we choose to live in darkness. We acknowledge your just judgment and confess that we deserve to be cast away from your presence for all eternity. We trust not ourselves, but in your mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord, grant us forgiveness for the sake of him who sacrificed his very life that we may have eternal life. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should repent. Upon this your confession, I, as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I assure you that all of your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands.
Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they display their knowledge.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple.
The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous.
They are more precious than gold, than much more pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever.
The ordinances of the Lord are sure and righteous.
The congregation may be seated. Pray. Stir up our hearts, O Lord, to make ready the way of your only begotten Son, that by his coming we may be enabled to serve you with pure minds, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We now hear the Old Testament lesson.
The Old Testament lesson today is from the 40th chapter of Isaiah, beginning with the first verse. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended and her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all his sins. A voice cries, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry. And I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up on a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength. O Jerusalem, herald of good news, lift it up, fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom, and gently lead those that are with young. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson today comes from the third chapter of 2 Peter, beginning with the 8th verse. But do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day as is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all of these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these, be diligent to be found by him, without spot or blemish, and at peace. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Will arise in honor of the Holy Gospel, which is recorded according to the Gospel of Saint Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
This will also be the basis for the sermon today, particularly the first verse, the beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness, and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. and all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locust and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The congregation may be seated. Theme, and that's the title for the message today. My goal is that for this morning's message is that this verse of Mark, where it speaks about Jesus as the reason, the whole purpose for this gospel, will so enable Jesus to infuse us with his spirit that was promised, infuse us with his own precious self and his awesome love, his divine love, that our lives may be changed, even in these very angry times, to a loving time. The gospel for this new year is going to be focusing on the gospel of Mark. And I thought it's appropriate to say just a little bit about that in introduction. Mark was not one of the disciples like Matthew was or John was. Luke also was not a disciple. Mark, however, was mentioned as a possible son, or definitely treated like a son by Peter. And most of the scholars today believe that Mark was writing for Peter. Anyway, Peter gave him the information. And also that of the what we call the first three Gospels, the Synoptic Gospels, because they're very similar in so many places, identical in many places, that the other Gospels, Matthew and Luke, made use of Mark. Mark was probably the first Gospel that was written. But what I really like about Mark is that it's a forceful Gospel. It's a short Gospel. It's the shortest Gospel. But it comes bam, slap, bam, right in your face. Jesus Christ. And in fact, that first verse, it says, the beginning about Jesus Christ. And actually, about is not in the Greek. It's an interpretation. But it could be read, the beginning, the middle, and the whole enchilada is Jesus Christ. He's the main event. Right in your face. Bang. And that is so important for us to realize. Oh, how precious our Lord Jesus is. In fact, of all the things of this awesome world that we experience for our whole lives and throughout the whole universe, Jesus Christ is the one and only essence, person, thing, if you will. I'm reluctant to call Jesus a thing. But Jesus is the only one that is absolutely necessary. There will come a time in each of our lives where we won't care about what kind of dress we have on, or the shelter that we have, our home, or the kind of car we're going to drive, or even the food that we're going to eat. But when we're before the throne of grace, the one that we claim and we hold on to, and the only one that we need, absolutely need, is Jesus. He is the source of Jesus' power and love, Jesus' power and life, life eternal. This is so very important. This is a season of Christmas, and whether it's secular society or in the church, religious society, even peoples of other religions, Christmas is so special. I think it's a unanimous decision around the world. Christmas is a wonderful time of the year. Christmas is a special time for love. And our expectations of love are so great at this time of the year. The problem is, if it isn't centered in the real source of the power of that love in Jesus, it becomes tied up with materialism. It can be tied up with things. It can be tied up with gifts and the decorations. All of this is wonderful, as long as they're only simply means of demonstrating that love. Oh, how often, as I have dealt with many, many, many families over the many years that I've pastored, that I've seen people get themselves into trouble. They will use their credit cards and they want to make a super duper Christmas. This will be the greatest Christmas ever. And they put on their max out their credit cards, MasterCard, then their Visa, then their Discover card. And if they have an American Express, max them all out. And what a Christmas. Oh, the gifts. Oh, the glitter. Maybe even a special Christmas getaway at a resort. and then be in serious, serious financial trouble, enslaved by the debt that they incur. And what should be a joyful time, wonderful time, suddenly swallows them up. Jesus isn't about that. Jesus is about the giving of himself. He's about authentic love, the real thing. I will never forget a wonderful, lovely couple, Greenwood and Marilyn. They were two Creole folks and lived in central Louisiana. Both of them were plagued by serious psychosis. They were mentally ill, but functional. Marilyn at one time had held a very responsible position in the city structure of Detroit, Michigan. She was from Alexandria, Louisiana. But one day she was troubled and the illness hit her. She came back home. And there she met Greenwood. And the Lord would have it, they fell in love and got married. And they had a nice, you know what a shotgun house is? At that long, narrow house. You could open up the front door and all the doors between all the rooms. And that's why it's called a shotgun. You can shoot in the front door and it goes out the back door without hitting anything. Frame house, it was right next to their mama's house and daddy's house. Lovely little cottage, and they were happy. And it was their first Christmas together, and they had saved, and they hadn't been overly extravagant, but they'd really outdone themselves. They decorated, they had a beautiful tree, and it was right before Christmas, and they had all their gifts bought already. And they were under the tree, and the house caught fire. It was only by God's grace and a sheer miracle. I don't have time to tell you the whole story, but it's totally awesome that they were saved, that they came out of that situation alive. But as I came on the scene, oh, Pastor, we lost our Christmas. It's so easy for us to get things kind of wackadoo about what's really important. I don't know how many times, we say, well, this family, they wouldn't have Christmas if it wasn't for Aunt Tilly who brought some gifts for the tree because they're on hard times. It won't be Christmas this year, son, because Daddy's lost his job and things are just real tight. See, what's wackadoo? What's missing and all that? The great Christmas is love. The greatest thing that we are all looking for is love. The reason we search so hard to get the right gift for our wives or our husbands or whatever, our children, our grandchildren or whatever, because we're looking for their love, but we love them so much. And we want to express our love. But that love, you see, I'm preaching is Jesus. When we receive Jesus, God so loved the world. Let's see if I can do this properly. I was thinking of drawing. I used to use a chalkboard. Maybe I should get a chalk. We don't have chalkboards anymore, do we? Old-timer. Okay. There's a big difference between when we say love and when we say God's love. The love when we talk about Jesus-given love. My love is a love that is corrupted by sin. And what that means is that my love by itself is a selfish love. And it kind of works like this. I will love you as long as you love me. But if you don't love me, then you just go your way and I will go my way. Selfish love is like this. I need you. I need your love. And if I don't get my way about how you show that love, you see, I will become angry. And ours is, by the way, a very angry society for the most part. Have you noticed that? There's a lot of anger. And I think an awful lot of that anger comes is that by nature as human beings, we're not getting our way. There's only one in the universe who gets his way, and he has all authority in heaven and on earth, and his name is Jesus. And he's the one we celebrate. He's the love that comes down at Christmas. And this is what Mark is all about. Bang, Jesus. Because when Jesus comes, he brings a love that is God's love, and that love is altogether different. This is a love that is sacrificial, meaning my love is that love from Jesus is unconditional. It's God so loved the world. What kind of world? A sinful world. A world in rebellion. He came and died, saved, gave Jesus as our gift of love. It is not, 1 John puts it this way. I preached on it on Wednesday. He puts it this way. Love is not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and gave his son to be the means by which our sins are forgiven. God loves us and gave us Jesus and suffered and died in the person of Jesus Christ. That's God taking on flesh to pay the price for us, because not because we're so good, not because we're so lovable, but because we're so bad and so needy. We have no righteousness to bring before him. He is our righteousness, and he is the gift of love. And the beautiful thing is when Jesus rises, and it's Jesus, I'm so glad that everyone is here today, because Jesus is here. And what we are about is sharing Jesus. And we have the bread and the wine, and we share that, not as a snack, but we share Jesus, the resurrected, living Jesus. And he changes us to that forgiving. Oh, how much fun it is. That love which is unconditional, that has no time for holding grudges, however, no time for the anger and the hurt. Oh, there can be anger and hurt, but it's let go because of Jesus in us. When I was a young man, very young man, I started, I guess, 15 years old already. My father, I was the oldest son of a bricklayer's family from the old country, from Germany. And the tradition was that the oldest son passed on the trade. He had to learn the trade. So the oldest son started laying bricks when I was 15 years old. Well, not so much at 15, but working at it, messing around with it. But I'd go with my father every holiday, every summer. Summertime in St. Louis is hot. We had a car, we rolled down the windows. That was the air conditioner. We didn't have air conditioning in those days. We're talking about the 1950s, early 60s. And we'd stop at a stop sign, and that summer he'd be beating down on us. We'd been working all day, all sweaty, dirty. And the cars would be lined up at a stop sign in Kirkwood, Missouri, I remember. There was a little community, it was a poor community called Meacham Park, right close to the center of town. And there was a scrawny little guy. He'd walk between the cars. His name was Tony. And he had a mission. And his mission was to hand out gospel tracts. Everybody knew his name. Hi, Tony. Hi. Smile. Give you a greeting. God bless you. And you're trapped through the open window. Thank you, Tony. I was shocked one day. It was the afternoon. We're laying bricks on a scaffold. This is the day when a lot of the bricklayers, we built solid masonry. By that, I mean, it's like these walls are solid masonry, I believe. It means you got brick on the outside, but there's blocks on the inside called the bag. Anyway, you have that builds the wall all the way up, and when you get up towards the top, you get up on a scaffold. And come afternoon, everybody's a little tired and sometimes a little cranky, and I was working next to a fellow who was by nature a little cranky anyway. His name was Jim. He was a big old gruff guy, country boy. He'd drive in 60 miles to St. Louis to work with us. But he was rough. His language was rough. His lifestyle was real rough. In fact, his nickname was Big Bad Jim. I mean, they just flat called him Bad Jim. Well, I couldn't hardly believe it. We were up there working, sweating, carrying on, doing the work. And up comes, we had a ladder up to the scaffold. And up comes Tony, climbed up the ladder, that little scrawny fella, handing out tracts. And he gets up on the scaffold with us. Now, the scaffold isn't all that big anyway. You got mortar boards and you got your bricks and all that thing up there. There's Tony getting over all that with his tracks. He said, "Oh, Jim, whoo!" He turned on him, and I wouldn't use the language in church what he used. And he said, "Blank, blank, 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 etc. And I'm going to kick your off of the." And for Jim, that wasn't an idle threat. And I go, oh boy, little Tony, half the size, maybe less than that of Jim. He falls on his knees, down on that old rough scaffold. I don't know, some of you have been in construction, but a bricklayer's scaffold has got all kinds of sharp chips of bricks and whatnot on it and whatnot from hammering away and whatnot. Down on his knees, and he starts praying and asking God to bless Jim and thanking God for Jim. And there you want to see a great big old man like David and Goliath. Oh, Jim just turned back to the wall. I heard him mumble, "You can't catch somebody who's praying for you." Such love. Such love knows no fear. Such love knows no bounds. Such love is unconditional. Such love forgives even the roughest, crudest guys, our girls. And that such love has loved us and made us the Lord's. And that is a marvelous gift that comes down at Christmas, and it we find in Jesus. When you ask Jesus to come into your heart, as I ask him to come in my heart, as we close by singing Sanctuary. And Lord, make us a sanctuary. Now may the peace of God and the love of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in this true Christian faith unto life everlasting. Amen. The congregation will arise as we confess to one another and before God the Nicene Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again from the dead in the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life for the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God and Father, we thank you so much for your many blessings. Day in and day out, you work awesome miracles in our life. You show your glory by your love and your healing and your strength. We pray, O Lord, that you would be with all those who are not able to join us because of weakness or illness. We pray, O Lord, a very special blessing for all of those who sit and watch and are facing various crises in their lives. We pray that you might pour out your Holy Spirit upon them, bind them together in your one great forever family. We thank you, O Lord, for your countless blessings. We thank you for all of those that serve us, our leaders in our nation and in our churches. We pray that you strengthen and guide them by the power of your Spirit. Bless them and their families. We pray, O Lord, for all of our first responders, our police and firemen, our EMTs, our people who serve us, our healers, our doctors, our nurses. We pray that you strengthen and use them for your glory. Thank you, Lord, for your many, many blessings. And we trust ourselves and our loved ones into your almighty care. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, whose way John the Baptist prepared, proclaiming him the promised Messiah, the very Lamb of God, and calling sinners to repentance. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying... in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
We do the words of institution. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The congregation will be seated, and we sing, "O Lamb of God." The elders will come forward, and I will commune you first. Precious body of Jesus. Take and drink the precious blood of Jesus shed for you. And now may this precious body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in the true faith and joy unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
Trumpet sound and angels sing. Listen to what they say. That man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. That man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day.
Oh, thank the Lord and sing his praise. He leads his people out of joy. Your hallelujahs raise. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch.
The Lord is our righteousness.
He shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land.
This is the name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
This is the name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen.
Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, Christmas angels, the great glad tidings.